Well, hello everybody. I know this is our week off for Memorial Day weekend and things like that, but the three of us decided to get together and do a little bit of an encore presentation in our current series here, or wrapping up our current series here, and that was the habits of successful plate umpires. Now, we've spent a lot of time looking at habits and skills that really successful plate umpires do manifest. And we talked about things like our pre-pitch routine and how important that is for us to perceive and call a fair and accurate strike zone. That was our first segment. Second segment that we took a look at then was the proper use of eyes to go ahead and call that fair and accurate strike zone. And we kind of labeled those two segments together, part one of strike zone strategy and then part two of strike zone strategy, in the larger theme this season of habits of successful plate umpires. The last week of the season, here we talked about efficient movements as to when exactly we can move away from point of plate. And then here today, one final thing that we want to make sure we talk about, and just do so very briefly and very deliberately, is the habit then of being able to manage the game as the plate umpire. It's kind of our last and final thing here that we've kind of noticed and put in our list of what most successful plate umpires do. So today's focus here in this encore presentation we're excited to get to you is really then on ways in which to manage the game. So game management strategies as the plate umpire is our topic of focus here for us today. Now, the three of us all have three different categories we'll talk about. I'll talk about the whole concept of going unnoticed. DJ will go ahead and talk about pace of play strategies. And then Seth will go ahead and bring us home at the end with building positive working relationships with players, managers, coaches, league administration, and things like that. So we've got a lot of good things here on tap here for us today. Really then to go ahead and talk about, as I mentioned here, the larger theme, and that is managing the game as one of the ultimate habits here of a successful plate umpires. Now, I'll go ahead and share my screen with everybody here for us. And as it pops up, just a couple things here, as I mentioned, to talk a little bit about in terms of where we were going. And I want to at least make sure that we tie back to where we were last week and really kind of give one little point of clarification here. Remember, we talked about in episode one, our pre-pitch routine, second episode, proper use of eyes. And as I mentioned, those kind of went back through and took a look realistically at how we can perceive the strike zone and then call that fair and accurate strike zone as well. But last week, or the last week of the season, episode three, we looked at four situations that would give us efficient movement as the plate umpire. One of those was going out on, as I mentioned in the video, trouble balls. And as I was reading through some of the manuals and talking with some other people, it's important to note here that the plate umpire is responsible for both routine and trouble balls. So even though we broke down trouble balls and things like that, we want to make sure we include routine and trouble balls in the opportunities that allow us to leave from point of plate as you know, the plate umpire here with no runners in scoring position. Second one we broke down was trailing the batter runner to first base. The third one was rotating to third base. I mentioned one situation that was R1 only. Also on the 60-foot diamond, not only will we be responsible for rotating up to third base, but the other correction to make then is that we'll also rotate with first and third situations. So it's R1 only and R1 and R3. So just 2 points there, real quick of clarification that allow us to move from behind the plate, especially in those rotation situations. And then we also mentioned lining up the tag attempt there in episode three. Now, again, these were a huge piece of the habits that are really then manifest by many successful plate umpires, especially the ones that we get to see on TV and do their thing. And the last kind of concept here for us to really think about then is the ways in which we manage the game. So our encore presentation today, all about managing the game. And the first major concept here, the first major theme that we would like you guys to think about here is this phrase, because it's one that we've oftentimes given advice to, and it's kind of become like a slogan or a mantra here in umpiring. The best umpires are the ones that go unnoticed. And I think, and we think that this is good advice to an extent, because there are times here where we actually have to be noticed. You know, our job is obviously to manage the game, to make sure everyone is safe and things of that nature. So this is kind of this like a half-baked advice. Brian DeBrower, who's been on with us before us, calls this phrase, the best umpires are the ones that go unnoticed, as half-baked advice. So if we fully bake it, there's another phrase to go ahead and add to it. And that is, the best umpires are the ones that go unnoticed when there's no need to be noticed, or the best umpires are the ones that go unnoticed until it's necessary to be noticed. So for example, you know, there may be times where you get two managers that are just, you know, talking and yapping at each other. Well, there comes a situation where we have to stand in the way of that. Safety would be another situation where we have to go ahead and stand in the way, or at least go ahead and manage the situation there. So it's important to kind of make sure that we start to find balance in areas where we can be unnoticed, and then the opportunities where we actually need to be noticed. And those are those points where really everybody in the crowd knows that the umpire should handle the situation. So with this phrase, the best umpires are the ones that go unnoticed, We definitely want to go unnoticed when there's no need to be when there's no need to be noticed, and we want to be noticed when it's time to lead. And we as umpires are there to lead. So the question here then, when we have this opportunity, is whether or not we are a conflict creator or a problem solver in a given situation. And handling situations basically becomes our calling card. It can become our reputation and things like that as well. And ultimately, this perception of whether or not you are a conflict creator or a problem solver is all rooted in how exactly you phrase things and how you relate to people. And that's exactly some of the areas that Seth will talk about a little bit later here today too. But what I mean here by this is if you get a situation, so for example, you're between innings, you look over and you've got, you know, like three hitters, three on deck hitters that are out in a little league game that are out trying to warm up and get their swings in. Obviously, the rule book says in that situation, in between innings, only one hitter, the leadoff hitter, can be out on out to swing the bat. So instead of, you know, yelling across the diamond, "Hey, only one on deck is allowed," you know, that's more of a conflict creator situation. A problem solver walks on over there and he would say something like, you know, "Hey guys, I hate to be the bad guy, but the rule book tells me that only one of you guys is unfortunately allowed to be out, and that's you because you're leading off in the inning." And that completely mitigates the conflict. It shows here that you've got compassion and understand where they're coming from and things of that nature. The same is true with the equipment check. Like if you're doing an equipment check and you're there to be, you know, the guy that's just, you know, really splitting hairs and things like that. And I know safety is a big concern for us, but guys, we've got to take the long end of the stick in things as well. And how we phrase things, the way we go about stuff, and just being practical in our communication and understanding and empathetic in our communication is really important. So, you know, this whole phrase, the best umpires are the ones that go unnoticed. It's half-baked advice because, yes, we want to go unnoticed when there's no need to be unnoticed. But at the same time, when there comes situations to be handled, we've got to step in and be the leader on the diamond here. And when we are a leader, are we acting as a conflict creator or a problem solver by the way that we go ahead and speak and relate to people and how we handle situations? So as we talk about managing the game and as DJ and Seth get into their strategies and things like that, I think this is the whole concept, the big picture to go ahead and recenter back to in our strategies to number one, emphasize and enforce pace of play. And then secondly, build those relationships that specifically allow us then to go unnoticed until there's need to be noticed. DJ, all you here.
All right. Hey guys, so we're just gonna talk about pace of play, another avenue of managing the game. The first thing that, you know, pops up for me is when we're talking about, you know, pace of play, things that we have control over. Obviously, if we're in the middle of an inning and we got pitches and baseball happening and stuff like that, we can't really control that. So we need to capitalize on those downtimes. And the first downtime that I can think of is, where do we stand between innings? We need to be standing on the side of the guys that we just got out. We need to be standing on the defense as they're coming out. We need to be hustling them in and out, making sure that we're communicating to the players, to the coaches. Honestly, it takes that first half inning and they kind of catch on. You know, we're looking for, you know, 1 minute in between each innings or each half inning. Technically that, you know, that one inning can start at the third out of the previous inning. So it needs to be a quick hustle. Depending on your COVID restrictions, you may or may not have plate meetings this year. That's something that you can talk about in a plate meeting, just to give the coaches a heads up that we're going to be looking for that 1 minute, have a pitcher and a legally equipped player ready to go. So that's one thing that we can do. And then, you know, the, who are we talking to? I already kind of talked about, you know, talking to the coaches and making sure that they're aware of the time and what you're looking for, but also speaking with the catcher and the pitcher as well. You know, letting them know how many pitches they have left, even the on deck batter, communicating to the on deck batter and letting them know. So that way, as that ball goes down, you know, we call balls in, we're taking it to two. And as that ball goes down, you're walking up to the plate, brushing it off if it needs it, taking your spot, getting the on deck better in there, ready to go. As you start to get to tournament level play, whether that be district, state, on up, you also have to communicate to the press box too. It's a good opportunity to make sure that we're paying attention to them as well. So those are just some things you should talk to. And on the opposite of that, who we shouldn't talk to, we shouldn't be talking to our partners. The plate guy coming down or the line, and then the field umpire coming down to converse. We lose time there. We lose track of time. We have no control. We want to pace of play is about making sure that we're not being noticed, as Stu just talked about, but we're just maintaining the flow of the game. That's incredibly, incredibly important. So I want to make sure that we're hammering home that if you're running two or three or four, make sure that your umpires are up out of the field of play, grabbing a water or something like that and coming right back in. The way that I look, a quick breakdown, for pace of play, it is honestly right here. There's roughly, if you go full six innings in a Little League baseball game, and you have 3 minutes at every half inning, you're going to be playing longer. The game's going to take 22 minutes longer, just right there. That's just half inning. So you're talking about going an hour and 40 versus 2 hours. 2 hours is fine. I like an hour and 40. That's just me. That is just a small example of the impact of pace of play. Just talking about, just the between innings right there. So another way that we can manage pace of play is with manager visits and charge conferences. So first, what is a visit? That's the defensive manager calling time, coming to talk to any member of the team. It's important to remember that. We want to make sure that we're communicating with that manager too. We're not trying to hide anything and being direct, hey coach, that was your first visit, as he's walking back. There's tons of different ways to go about it. Whether you've got a timer, using a base umpire with a watch or something like that. For me, it's if they're going to go out and talk to their pitcher, I call time, grant time. I wipe the plate. By the time I'm done wiping the plate, I'll go a few feet up the line, just away from the batter's box, essentially, count to maybe five and start my walk. And it's not a fast walk. It's just a purposed walk, giving them the time. This is Little League. This is instructional. We want to make sure that we're affording them the opportunity to instruct their players and coach their players while managing the pace of the play. And that's why we're there. And as we're going back, making sure that the coach knows of his visit, and then a light jog back to the plate. We want to make sure that we're showcasing hustle. We talked about, I believe it was Jose last episode talked about over hustling, the concept of over hustling. A light jog there showcases that you're still in the game. Just not to forget, we did have a rule change a few years ago. I'm not going to try and quote the year, but we dropped visits per game and per inning. You got two visits. On the second visit on that pitcher, he's got to be removed. So you've got one. As that coach is coming out for the second visit, let him know right away, coach, he's done, he's got to go. And it's twice an inning or three times an entire game for one pitcher. So just kind of keep that in mind, making sure you're documenting that on a scorecard and communicating with those coaches, because sometimes they might not know whether or not they've been charged a visit. And then the last thing are those pitching changes and who do we communicate with? Whether that's, kind of like a between innings thing, we've communicated with the manager and let them know visits or those types of things. We're communicating with, again, at district or tournament level play or higher, we're communicating with scorekeeper. We're communicating with on deck batter. There might be situations where you have to record this information on the scorecard or talk to the scorekeeper. Make sure your partners, your field umpires, are keeping track of those visit or those pitches, rather. So that way, when you're able to bring your full attention back to the field of play, that base umpire can flash you. He's got four pitches left, or he's got three pitches left, whatever the case may be. So that way, everybody's on the same page. But we're not yelling. We're not hollering. We're not being noticed, because we don't need to be noticed. For that situation, nonverbal communication right there. So, the last thing, just given the info, all those types of things, going out, making sure that we're just, as soon as the pitcher is ready to go, you got one pitch left, getting our position back, getting the batter in, putting the ball in play. We don't need to do any exaggerated communication with the pitcher. We would hope that their responsibility is to know the current situation that they're being brought into the game. So do you guys have anything else you want to add on when it comes to pace of play? That's all I got.
Seth, you got anything?
No, I'm good. DJ pretty much hit all of it.
Yeah, I think, you know, one point, and DJ made this point a couple different times, is, you know, we just went through a couple different examples here where pace of play comes in place. And that was really all our goal to do. And DJ mentioned the whole idea that your job in each of these types of situations is to maintain the flow. And that's our responsibility. That's active officiating. You know, you can go get a drink of water, and as DJ said, come back to the defensive side, or, you know, whichever side really you want to stand on, and you know, get a sip of water there. You know, take, you know, your time, 30 seconds to get some water in, return it back, and then communicate there too. A couple strategies in between innings. I always say when there's two pitches left, I say two pitches to the pitcher, and DJ said two pitches to the on deck hitter. That way we know we're allowed to work. And then even if the kid calls balls in coming down, I usually say the same thing just to make sure that that voice is present. Not because it needs to be my voice, but just so that we know, you know, 12-year-olds, they need sometimes things to be said multiple times. So a couple different things there and tricks to say with regards to pace of play. And again, the whole purpose is to keep people in rhythm. The game goes quicker because people are in rhythm. People have more fun when they're in rhythm. People then play better when they're in rhythm. And, you know, these aren't the all-encompassing examples of pace of play mechanics, but nonetheless, there are a few examples here where we have to be actively officiating to maintain the flow, as DJ said, and keep everybody in rhythm. Other area here for us to talk about in terms of habits of successful umpires in the context of managing a game, aside from pace of play here, happens to be building relationships. And that goes in with being unnoticed until it's time to be noticed. So Seth, this one's all you here.
Yeah, so there's really three main categories of relationships that you're going to have while you're working a game at a particular league. And the first one's with your managers and coaches. These are the first people that we're going to talk to when we get to the field at our plate meeting. So it's very important that we are on rapport with them because, like I said, when it comes involving their team, they're who we're going to be talking to. So we want to know their name and we want to address them by their name. One, this helps us get their attention, much like we talk to our partners on the field. If Stu and I are working a game together and I'm rotating up to third, Stu, I'm going to third. He hears me. That gets his attention. It's the same way with these managers and coaches. If Stu's my coach and I say, hey, Stu, this is my issue, I need this fixed, it gets his attention immediately. He understands what the problem is. He can fix it. And then it also gives us the appearance of, you know, we see them as people. We don't see them as a coach. We see them as people. And them addressing us by our names, it's kind of a back and forth thing. So this is an easy way to just try to stay on the positive side of things and be able to get their attention. The next thing we want to do when we are talking to these guys is we want to understand what their questions are and what their concerns are when they approach us with an issue. And then our job and our aim and our job is to get the call right. A perfect example of this is I was working a game. This was a couple weeks ago, and I had a call at first base that I think it was a pulled foot that was on the back side of the bag, and I was on the inside of the diamond. So I had no shot at seeing how, unless he was totally far off the bag, that he was off. So I made my call, and then I immediately looked to the defensive team's dugout or the offensive, one of their dugouts, and I said, hey, Shane, do you want me to get help on that? Because he was coming out, and he just said, yep, no problem, and turned around, went back to the dugout, went and got help, no problem. So then that kind of goes back to DJ's pace of play thing. You know, I could have called time, waited for Shane to come out to me, talk about the issues, then go for it. Instead, I nipped it in the bud right there. I said, Shane, do you want me to get help? Yes, okay. Got it taken care of. And again, that just helps keep things on a positive relationship. It shows them that we're willing to work with them if we have something that comes up. The next person that we need to build a positive relationship with is our catcher. And this kind of goes without saying because as I tell my catchers, you know, you're the only thing between me and that baseball coming out of that pitcher's hand other than the batter's bat. And I can't totally rely on that bat to hit the ball every time. So it's important we're on a positive relationship with these guys. Obviously it goes without saying we need to know their names. Typically most of us introduce ourselves to our catchers anyway, so I didn't feel the need to totally mention and talk about that. But the thing I want to hammer home here is we want to work with our catchers. We don't want to work against them. And what I mean by that is good example here is if you have a catcher that catches a borderline pitch that you call a ball and they're kind of sticking it, just tell them where you have it. You know, I was doing it again, working a game the other day, borderline pitch, ball. Hey, Logan, that's outside. I have that outside. That way he knows that it's outside. And he starts to learn that zone a little bit, but at the same time, again, it's, you know, telling them we're not squeezing them or trying to squeeze them and try to keep information from them. The other part of this too is, different game. I had a catcher catch a nice, low outside knee ball. I mean, it was a perfect outside corner knee ball and it went to his glove and it fell out and it was a perfect pitch. I called it a strike. No problem. I got a little bit of flack from the backstop, but I knew I was going to get it. After he threw the pitch back, I said, "Hey, Peyton, you and I both know that's a strike. You've got to do me a solid and catch that, because I did you a solid and I got you a strike there when some people may not have." And so again, it just, we want to make sure with our catchers that we're working with them, not against them. And again, because they're the only thing between us and the baseball. So, obviously it'd be real easy for them to kind of hit us on that. So work with them, not against them. And then the last people that we need to be on a positive rapport with is our league administration and our league officials. And the number one thing here is we want to know who our OD or our league official on duty is. And we want to know their name, what they look like, what color shirt they're wearing. Typically most leagues will have like, a specific color shirt for that person, so they'll be easy to pick out. We want to be polite. Obviously we're a guest at the park. It's not our park and we're not letting the teams play here. You know, it's the league's park. So we want to, you know, be a guest. And then the kind of the last thing here is, we want to try not to be needy. And what I mean by needy is, you know, make sure that we take water out with us, whether that is, you know, bringing it from your house or stopping by the concession stand and grabbing water if your league allows you to do that before the game. Try to take enough baseballs with you or softballs if you're doing softball to the game site. Maybe take a couple extras if you're kind of far away from the building where everything's stored. Take a couple extras and store them in the dugout. We want to try to basically be self-sufficient on the diamond, so that way once we start the game, we can just, again, go with the flow of the game, keep that pace of play, and then be done and not to be a problem. You know, obviously circumstances arise and sometimes, you know, things happen and we have to take care of that. But at the end of the day, again, it goes back to the whole thing. We want to try to not be noticed until we need to be noticed. So being self-sufficient on the diamond and being polite to our league ODs and all that is an easy way to do that. DJ, you got anything on relationships here?
I love a good conversation with a catcher. I agree. Talk to him and let them know what you see. Let them know what you have, because they can in turn take that information and give it to a coach, and potentially keep a coach off your back. And it just creates a sense of trust. We're human. So that's something that's huge for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. DJ stole a word right out of my mouth, and that was trust. And like, whether it's, you know, handling the pace of play stuff or here building relationships, that's really what we're working towards, is we want to be trusted. And that's what we mean by going unnoticed until it's necessary to be noticed. We want our managers, our coaches, the fans, the kids, we want them to know that they're in good hands, that the game is going to be protected, it's going to be played the right way, and it's going to be in the environment that's supposed to be maintained and things are going to be handled. And that is essentially what we're getting to as this habit of successful plate umpires. That's one of the characteristics. These people are trusted based upon the way that they relate with one another, the way that they handle pace of play, and things like that. So building trust and building your reputation as someone that is trustworthy to maintain the game and maintain the way it's supposed to be, that's what we're working towards. That's what we're talking about in terms of building these relationships and pace of play. The last thing that I got here for us to go ahead and think about is, you know, we've given you guys a ton of things here in this series. You take a look at, you know, strike zone strategy with pre-pitch mechanics. There's a lot that went into that, a lot of fundamentals and habits that, you know, you got to work on. Same is true with tracking. Like, that's a diligent habit that you have to build. We talked about efficient movements from behind the plate. There's a lot that goes into that, too. So at the grander scheme of things, and I think a lot of us have probably found this to be true in our careers, is that in umpiring, we just feel like there is a lot that has to be done, and there's a lot to be done well. So when adversity hits, whether we're struggling, whether the game, we're getting a lot of flack from both dugouts and people are intense and, you know, all that kind of stuff. What do we come back to? What centers us? What grounds us? And this is basically the last piece I have here with regards to habits of successful umpires, is not only do they build those relationships and pace of play and go unnoticed, but they have a mechanism or ability to essentially recenter themselves in the face of adversity, in the face of pressure, and really be very calm and cool to not only handle situations, but to also officiate at a very high level. So what exactly keeps you in the moment? And when we face adversity, the reality is we default to our habits. And I know one of our focal points this year was using 2021 as an opportunity to build back the habits and fundamentals and those skills that we've relied on in our careers. Well, realistically, when it hits the fan and, you know, pressure's out there, or we're just struggling and not having a good game, we've got to find a way to recenter ourselves. And we do that by defaulting to our habits and having some positive self-talk. So that's kind of two big things, our habits and our self-talk. And that's gone through pre-pitch routine, proper use of eyes, and efficient movement. And those are three kind of different compartments as plate umpires that we can use to recenter and focus ourselves. Pre-pitch, take a breath, relax, get yourself aligned. In pitch, track it all the way in. That way you're seeing it clearly. Post pitch, do your thing with mechanics and make sure that they are clear and crisp, and obviously not reactions, but rather than responses to the information there. And then efficient movement is post pitch as well. So I think that gives us three different compartments then to build habits as we're working. But even when we're faced with challenges, three things here that really can be focused upon as we try then and stay in the moment and gain composure and gain control of the situation. And again, our job is to be problem solvers. So even as we are struggling, or if the game is intense and we have to, you know, handle situations and people and things like that, you know, our job is to problem solve. It's not to exacerbate or create conflict with the ways in which we handle situations. It's to problem solve, to gain trust, as DJ said here as well. And the last kind of thing here with regards to this is, you know, I think Mark Bernstein was on back in December with game management, had a great, great seminar for us in 3 Up, 3 Down. But he often talked about the fact that, you know, umpires and what we do here is a leadership program. What we do is leading. And that's exactly the bigger picture of what we're talking about here with these habits, specifically today in our encore presentation. Now, these habits take time, and I've tried to make sure that we have encouraged you to think about this stuff. And as we take a look at it scientifically, it takes more than 2 months, anywhere from 2 to 8 months, for any new behavior to become a habit. So what that means then for us is that we've got to realize here that building habits is not an all or nothing process. It's not something that we lose just because of one mistake. In fact, we have to make mistakes in order to learn from them and then reverse the behavior, whether it be the way we handle situations, pace of play, building relationships, pre-pitch routine, whatever the case may be. Building habits is not an all or nothing process. It does not matter if you mess up every now and then. But what matters is your response to that. And when we mess up and we struggle and we feel like things are unraveling, what do we default or refer back to? The answer is our habits. And if we can take advantage of the routine plays, take advantage of the easy ones, and you know, some of that, you know, just boring nature of the game, because realistically, the game does call itself for probably 95% of it, right? We're just window dressing for the other part. So in 95% of the game, we have an opportunity to build habits so that when the pressure's on us and we're going to be noticed, we default to those habits, we look dynamite here, and ultimately we have those habits ingrained in us as successful plate umpires here. Again, get all that stuff from James Clear. He's an author, wrote the book Atomic Habits, which is a great one to look at for those of you guys who are avid readers. But again, you know, our habits are so important to how exactly we attack the game and then how we really manage the game as well, not only then for the game's participants to keep them in the flow or keep them in rhythm, but also then to ground ourselves so that we're in the right set mentally, and then that our habits are out there too for us to manage the game successfully. So just a couple things here for us to go ahead and think about as we continue then in this whole conversation in understanding what exactly makes a successful plate umpire, both in pitch and calling pitches, post pitch in dealing with anything that could happen with the ball in play, and then here managing situations in game management, a huge piece then of the characteristics of successful plate umpires. DJ Seth, anything else here for us here?
No, there was one point at the end of the pace of play, you talked about rhythm and how the players, you know, play better and the coaches coach better. I feel that we as umpires umpire better. My mood is great, is so much higher when I know that I'm trekking through a game and it's 45 minutes to an hour and we're already into the fourth or fifth inning. That's a good mood to have. So you said that, and I wanted to circle back to that, but trust and habits are two huge takeaways from this whole series. So big key points there.
Yep. 100% agree with all that.
Well, everyone, we appreciate you and your time, attention, and everything else. And we've gotten a lot of feedback from people just about how much they appreciate the content we put together. And Seth and DJ, I really appreciate you two. You know, the three of us, you know, talk probably way more than we should about planning and things like that. But, you know, we love it. We enjoy it, and definitely hope that the content we've been able to provide in our last few seasons here, three up, three down, and our 30 plus episodes so far has been useful to you and helped you get better on the diamonds here. We're excited to launch our next series here coming up. Remember, we're off this week for the Memorial Day weekend. Everybody relax, enjoy that time. Take some time to spend for yourself, for your family, and things like that. Get recharged, because tournament season is knocking on our door. And to help us get ready for tournament season, not only will we have some tournament rules and resources to go ahead and release during our next episodes of Three Up, Three Down, but our topic will be on Little League's new four umpire system to be used on the 60-foot diamond. So we'll break that down in four different segments in June. June 4th at 12:30 p.m. will be our first segment then, taking a look at the basic rotations and responsibilities of each of the four umpires in the four umpire system. We're real excited to roll that out, share Little League's new four umpire system with you guys, and get everyone starting to use that one as they can for tournament play, and getting everybody ready then for the international tournament, which is obviously upcoming here for us. But again, appreciate everyone and your time and attention in this season and all the seasons. Obviously, you can find a lot of our content in our archives on our YouTube page. And then obviously, we've also then got in the future here a real exciting look on June 4th on a four umpire system. But other than that, this is DJ and Seth here. And for Three Up, Three Down, reminding you to use those eyes properly and stay chest to ball. And obviously, have a bunch of fun on the diamond as we all try and use 2021 to get back to what we love and get, you know, really good, or at least a little bit better at what we're doing. Thanks to everyone. And we'll see you on June 4th then for the four umpire system first episode. We'll see you then. Thanks, everyone.